Greetings fellow gamers, and welcome to another episode of our Let's Explore series. Today we will continue adventuring with Skuldar, our Stout-axe dwarf. Here we are at the Thorin's Gate area. We are going to finish questing here and proceed down the Thrain's Vale. As you can see in the map, we're going to finish up this area and proceed down to the Vale of Thrain as we explore Eredluin. Let us get started. So we have a quest for dwelling. We have an armor to fix, to seal the fissures, and this is for Noglond later on. Okay. So let's get inside Thorin's Gate to proceed with our quests. As you can see, it's night. It's nighttime, and there are lots of stars. It's really amazing how much detail the developers have put into the game. Let me use an accelerator in order to be able to travel faster. Okay, so there's a quest over here.
Greetings, traveler. I would be grateful for your assistance.
Okay, so there are several gears we need to find. We already found one, and we must proceed with the rest of them. If you remember from our latest episode, those gears are used in order to open a vault inside the mountain with some treasure in it. The gears have been scattered because the Daurhands were in control of the mountain halls, and the long birds didn't want them to have access to this treasure. Okay, let's see. Okay, so we need to go to Noglund to proceed with this quest. We'll do that later on. Look at that waterfall. It's amazing the fact that that is inside a mountain hall of the dwarves. So the dwarves have running water inside their mountain hall. They can last in the case of a siege. They have running water, they have pets, as you can see here, kind of livestock. They have lots of supplies, of course, and they're well prepared. So defenses, running water, supplies, everything they need is here. They have forges to make or repair weapons. And the best of it is the dwarves themselves. We are master fighters and warriors, have very good armor, have very good weapons. Okay, so we are repairing the canal walls to make sure there's no flooding. That would be devastating to the infrastructure here. Okay. So we're done here, if I'm right, and we must talk to Dwalin in order to inform him about the hilt, with short hilt we found of a dead Darhand. If you remember, there was a theft from the Darhands that stole some gold, and we have to investigate where this gold has gone in order to retrieve it. As you might know, dwarves are very greedy, and especially when it comes to gold, precious metals, precious jewels. They're very protective of their riches. It's very important to them. So here it points out that dwarves have long used thrashes, and you can use them as spies. They're also using ravens, as mentioned in The Hobbit, especially in Erebor, the Lonely Mountain. There was even a specific location known as Raven Hill, where the dwarves used to have nests for the ravens, and they were used as spies or messengers between the various clans and the dwarven strongholds. It's a very clever way of communicating and, of course, spying against your enemies. And so we are going to use those thrashes in order to obtain some knowledge about what happened and where did the Darhands go with our gold, with Longbeard gold. We're not Longbeards, we are Stout-axes. But of course, we care about Longbeard dwarves, since they have provided refuge from us. Let's see, our gear, is there any point in changing? Not sure, to be honest. Okay, let's see. Okay. Lots of armor, but no agility. I'm not going to change it yet. Okay, so there are more water problems and canal problems. This is probably the canal that is causing the problem. If you're not aware, inside the game, the Lord of the Rings Online, there are also homesteads. The latest episode, we explored the west area. And here there are lots of goblins, there's a lot of mining. There are a couple of caves and armories of dwarves. And on this side, there are also mines, the Silver Deep mine, the ruins of Edelion, the Elven ruins, and also more caves And the Berghold, where was the tomb of Skorgrim. There are also Thorin's homesteads. We're going to visit those in order to see how magnificent these are. I really like the concept that the housing system of Lotro is very nice, and it's very well integrated into the game, meaning that you cannot have a house in a war zone or a desolate area. Houses are part of more civilized areas, like Thorn's Gate, like Bree, like Shire. Of course, in the southern point of Ered Luin, there are the Ilven homesteads, and we're going to get there eventually. So, the latest episode, we explored this area. There are tunnels, there are caves, there are armories. And over here is the entrance for the homesteads. As you can see, it's the same design, meaning doors with the mountains on them. Here's the canal that was mentioned before. It flows down the vale. And let's explore over here as well. I'm going to enter a random homestead. Let's see. So this entire area is a very big cave, and the dwarves have built around here, as you can see, of course, columns, gateways, arches, statues, and stairways. And inside all this area, you can buy a home. The home you can decorate, you can put items, you can store items, you can use decorations, lamps, trees. As you can see over here, there are trees in the courtyard. There are doormats. I don't know if you can enter this. This is the home of Edelanor, I don't know how it's pronounced. Let's see if we can, you can access it. Of course, very nice. So you can see you can have lots of things in here. You can have maps, you can have kegs, drums, loot from instances, from festivals. And there are fireplaces. As you can see, they're from the taxidermist, or fishing trophies. There's lots of items to use and put in here. And there are also decorations you can store in the chest items. Of course, there are multiple types of homes. This is a deluxe house, if I remember correctly. There are normal houses, deluxe houses, and there are kinship houses. Kinships are like an alliance. There's a group of people that have a structure. There are officers, there's a leader. They can have a kinship house and store items. Of course, it's a social aspect of the game. It's very interesting. You can have a kinship that can do raids, that participates in festivals, that assist each other in crafting and questing. So it's mainly a social aspect of the game that it's very popular. Okay, so this is one house. There are several houses. As you can see, there are various roads that lead to houses, small and big. There are smaller houses. As you can see, there are normal and deluxe houses for players. And there are the bigger houses that are kinship houses. Of course, there are slight differences in the locations. They are not identical, in order to provide some variety, because it wouldn't be nice if all the houses were in a perfect grid. And this offers a lot of variety. In there might be more elevation, there might be a canal, a bridge, or a different portion of the cave, so they're not exactly the same houses. Of course, there are multiple instances of these housing neighborhoods to provide enough houses for all the people on the server. And another point to note is that each player can have only one house per server. So if I buy a house, all my other players on Lotro will, in the same server, will be able to access that house. That doesn't apply to kinship. To kinship houses that are only available to members of the kinship. Okay, we can proceed. As you can see, there's a bridge here, so depending on what part of the neighborhood you like, and you can actually try and find a house over here. Of course, you must pay rent. It's a way to handle the in-game economy. Rent is paid in with gold that you can get from quests or selling loot. I find very nice that the whole housing area is inside the mountain. Now I'm trying to get to the main area of the housing neighborhood. As you can see here, there are even parts of the housing area that can be used for social events between kinships, inside servers. There can be players acting or performing with music. Lotro has an amazing music system. And it's part of the culture of Lord of the Rings itself. There are multiple instances where tales or songs are being sung and told. They're very important aspects of the culture and the history of Middle-earth. The fact that songs are told and they carry the history of Middle-earth, the feats and the heroic acts of people, elves, dwarves and men. It's the tradition of its people, of its race. Here there are various vendors or services, escrow broker, vault keeper. So it's like a market area for the housing neighborhood. So it's also a hub for socializing or providing various services to people that are inside the housing neighborhoods. Here are tasks. So there are also in-game service. It's an in-game service hub, and also there's lots of possibilities for socializing. For example, a kinship might have a social event inside the kinship house or the courtyard. Here are statues. It's amazing how the dwarves are using crystals as light sources and lamps. It's quite spectacular, I would say. Of course, some decorations might be kind of out of place because each player has the ability to decorate as it pleases him. For example, this Swan Fountain from Lorien. It's an Elvis decoration that it's kind of out of context in here, but of course each player is able to do what it pleases him. If we were, for example, role-playing, that might be quite frustrating to a character of dwarven descent to have elven decorations inside the dwarven neighborhood. Okay, let's proceed. I believe we have explored every part of Thorn's Gate by now. So we're going to proceed towards Noglond. Noglund is another settlement, an outpost further down the road to the south. And it's a quest hub, and of course has services, vendors, and a stable master. Let's see, we must talk to Willy here. Okay, let's use our the stable master to log Noglond. To show you, Noglond is down here. And now, this point where Thor's Gate, this is the area we are now. Noglond is down here. This is the Vale of Thrain. And using the stable master, we will be able to automatically travel there. So. As you can see, there are lots of names: Freren's Court, Thorn's Gate, and Thor's Halls, Vale of Thrain, down here. Those are names of dwarves of Longbeard descent. There are more ruins and fortifications, gateways, arches. Thorin, as you might know, is a dwarf of royal descent of the Longbeard clan. He's the hero of the Hobbit tale. Their Thorin's company tried to begin from starting an adventure for Ered Luin of this area, in this hall that has his name, and traveled to the mountain of Erebor, the Lonely Mountain, in order to reclaim the area from Smaug the Dragon, Smaug the Golden, he's known. That in that adventure, Bilbo Baggins took part after Gandalf urged him, and that ended in the events that Bilbo found the One Ring in the Misty Mountains, in the caves of the Misty Mountains, and claimed it from Gollum. So it's a very important tale in the context of the game and the events of the Lord of the Rings, of course. Thrain, on the other hand, was the father of Thorin. And the grandfather of Thorin was Thror. We are going to find there are other areas in the game that have taken names. Their names are inspired from those characters. And Thrain, the father of Thorin, was the latest dwarf known to have the Ring of Power, the Dwarven Ring of Power, that the line of Durin, also known as Longbeards, had. So the one of the seven rings of power of the dwarves, one of the Dwarven rings, ended up to Thrain, and it was taken from him in Dol Guldur by the forces of Sauron. And of course, he was lost, and not much was known of him, of his fate. So there are various settlements. As we can see, this minor settlement. There are not many dwarves or very large halls over here. Let's see what tales you can see here. Let's see, let's get some food. Okay, This quest is for the prologue, the Dwarven prologue. The epic quest line that this prologue is part of, it follows the main story, if we can say so, in the Lord of the Rings Online. There are quests that are primarily focused on the events of the Lord of the Rings. So we will follow various events either in preparation, either parallel or in advance of the of the Fellowship of the Ring. We will cooperate with characters like Aragorn, like Gandalf, Boromir, Legolas, the various characters, Gimli, of course, our fellow dwarf, that will follow these characters, their journey, their problems, their fights and struggles in order to get them to join the Fellowship, to carry out the tasks there. We will be asked to clean up after the Fellowship in order to cover their tracks or prepare the way for them to travel. And it's an intent-wide story. We either go parallel and watch the Fellowship from afar, either we do preparation work. It's very nicely integrated into the story. And of course, the most important part is that we take part in the story, not as the main characters that are, of course, known and mentioned in the books, but we are experiencing the events and stories from a different perspective. So there are several quest lines, epic books they're called in the game, that follow the preparation or the events, the actual events of the books. So these prologue quests are different for dwarves and elves and men and hobbits and burnings, of course. In order to get them all to Brilant, where the actual books start for all that are common for all races. And of course, we meet very famous characters and proceed from there. Okay, so have some loot here. Let's take this one. So there are more problems with the canal. Of course, dwarves are great engineers and builders, but they have lots of problems because there are goblins around here, there are beasts, there are Darhans, as you might remember. They're very recently reclaimed this area from the Darhans, as we saw in the introduction quests. And now they have lots of problems that they're trying to solve. Okay, there are various quests to defeat cats, to fetch armor in order to return to Thorin's Gate to repair it. What else? All sorts of quests. Okay. Let's see. Oh, we haven't talked to Nagli. We might do that as soon as we return. Okay, so we need to kill lynxes, the second gear, and bears. Let's see on the map. We are now here in Noglond. Okay, request Thorin's Gate. The canal is down to the south. Okay, we don't need to keep that. Okay, let's begin with the canal. As you can see, there are lots of archways. and bridges. There's a old dwarven stronghold over here, and that one, as we are told, is overrun by goblins. Goblins, of course, are the the arch enemies of dwarves, as well as orcs. There's rivalry with elves as well, but they're not. They don't hate each other as much as the dwarves and the elves hate orcs. So here is a tree that has fallen and has blocked the canal. And we must clear away all this stuff. We have to defeat bears as well to get meat, I believe. As you can imagine, in this winter terrain and the inside the caves where dwarves like to live, it's important to always have enough supplies, either meat, wood, leather, skins, metals, of course, and coal, stones, and so forth. So, okay, this is done, I believe. Let's kill some lynxes and bears. This is a Hentraval, it's a bird. Of course, in the game, as it is a massively multiplayer online RPG game, there are lots of quests of fetch X objects from that area, transport them to another area, or kill that number of enemies. Of course, that's not as interesting as the lore or some specific raiding quests or the story of some of the epic quests. But of course, if you consider it, to the people that the dwarves in this case that live in this area, it's very important to kill goblins, ensure they're safe, and fix problems with their canals or strongholds. They might be tedious jobs for us, as we are great heroes, as many dwarves refer to us. But it's important for the inhabitants of the area to be able to secure their homeland and be able to stock supplies and fix problems or investigate thefts, as is one of our quests. So we take part into this adventure, investigation, and all those quests and issues. Okay, so here is... Okay, so we need to return to Noglond for that. Clear the routes. Okay, so we need to defeat the bears and lynxes. Of course, there are progression systems in the game, either in getting better in the way you play the game, do more damage, be more stealthy, depending on your class, of course. And to be honest, it's a natural progression. If you kill hundreds of orcs, you'll be better and be more proficient. So it's important to practice our skills, newer or depending on our level. It refuses to fight back, but that doesn't matter. So here, as you can see, there's a lot of snow. It's a mountainous terrain. Dwarves love mountains. Of course, they love caves in mountains even more. Of course, mountains have lots of mineral and ore veins, which dwarves need in order to mine and craft things, armor, jewelry. They have lots of stone and that can be quarried and used to build halls. Lots of times the dwarves use the rock itself and carve out columns or gates from rock itself. That's very impressive. As we saw in the Thorin's Gate, most of the columns in there are carved outside, carved on the rock and the stone itself. Of course, there can be quarried and built in the normal way, if you can say so. But the dwarves are masters of carving and shaping the stone itself in order to create their halls and their defenses and things of beauty in general. Okay, we need some more lynxes. One more to finish the quest. There's also an amazing crafting system in the game. There are lots of vocations. You can mine for resources, you can get hides, you can farm, for example, and find the resources to create food or various other things. The most impressive of those, not for its usefulness, but its social aspect and how it integrates very well to the general aspect and the way that the Lord of the Rings races exist is the pipeweed, which can be harvested and planted, harvested from farmers, and then you can smoke it, as it's very well described in the Hobbit and Lord of the Rings. There are lots of cases that either Bilbo, Aragorn, Gandalf use pipeweed, and it's amazing that some varieties in the game used to two various shapes, dragons, and small fireworks. So it's very impressive. Okay, so we must defend him. I wouldn't say he can't defend himself, but whatever. And we got a level. Very nice. Get more fighting to be done. Of course, there's lots of fighting in this game. There are enemies everywhere, from lowly wildcats and bears to balrogs. You get to fight almost everything and anything. Okay. So we got the notes and must return them to Noglond in order to see I will deal with the thieves, the Darhand thieves. Let's find the road and the path to return to Noglund. The other impressive thing is that aside from the path, there are columns that show the way, and these are shaped in the dwarven way and architecture. So you can follow these columns even if you can't see the path or it's covered by snow, for example. And you can follow the road this way. Let's see. We have an earring we can equip. We have some food. Okay, there are the notes. Oh, and we got a dagger. Oh, right, that's Floss's dagger from the quest that we completed in the latest episode. Let's use this. So now we have two daggers. Daggers are suggested for burglars because they have a critical chance. Auto-attack critical chance. And in general, burglars use their critical attacks, and the way they fight, they require critical hits and events. As you can see here, there are markers, there are bridges, there are archways. I really like the architecture that the dwarves are portrayed to have in the game. Okay, let's see. Now we have to turn over the quests. Okay. That's a nice piece of equipment, and it also has agility. That's very important for dwarves, for burglars. Sorry. Okay, now we have to kill Hendrevel. These are the birds we saw earlier. In order to make sure the dwarves don't have lots of problems with them. Lots of quests in this area. Okay, so we have to assess the goblin threat. Let's see. An armband. Okay. There are more quests, and we need to proceed. So, from the notes we retrieved, we found out where the Darhand gold is. Where actually the Longbeard gold is that the Darhands have stolen. And here is another interesting thing, that the Darhands seem to work together with goblins and have allied with them. Don't forget that the Darhands, as we saw with Skorgrim, are allies of Angmar now. On the at least in the terms of the game, so they're both allies in the war against the free peoples, either Longbeard, dwarves, elves, men, and hobbits, of course. So there's an old Darhan city to the west. Of course, it is referred to older and ancient dwarven cities in the Blue Mountains, who of course are now in ruins, but the Darhands have made strongholds have made them their strongholds. Okay, not this one. I need to sell my loot. Let's see. We need to equip this one and this one. Okay. Okay. What's that? Not really. So we're going to sell everything. So we've completed a quest. Okay, this deed is for quests. Yes. So there's a mechanic in the game that it's called deeds. It's a specific log in the game. And in each area of the game, there are various deeds. Those deeds contain exploration. For example, discover all the places of the dwarves or the place of the elves. And important landmarks. There are also lots of slayer deeds. Kill so many goblins, kill so many enemies, dark hunts or bears, depending on the area, or orcs. And of course there are deeds for quests, in order to complete, if you can say so, the area, and try to help the inhabitants of the area proceed. And all sorts of deeds. Here, for example, the Red Loon so far found an exploration deed for places of the dwarves. And we are in progress for the quest deed. And also Goblin Slayer, as we have already slain lots of goblins. So, this is our third episode. That's the end of this episode. If you enjoyed our video, please like, comment and subscribe. Feel free to contact me, to adventure with me, do activities together, or even just to talk and comment over various things inside the game or in general for the Lord of the Rings. So, bye everyone.